Okay, can you see it now? Or can you just Okay. Can everybody hear me? See me?
Yes.
Okay, good.
But I can't see them. But you can hear.
All right, so today we're talking about balance and avoiding sleepier conditions. In a way, mainly what to do when you're entering something with this wet, snowy, anything like that. So we need to make sure that you are prepped for that. Just one more technical issue. Let me just address my computer sound.
Oh, that's yours.
Okay.
So, understanding balance. Balance relies on coordination between eyes, ear, muscles, and joints. So you have proprioceptor receptors, that's a joint receptors that tells you in what positions your joint or leg or knee or hand or shoulder is at any given time. Eyes, obviously, when you see things, automatically your nervous system will align you into vertical position. That's why we always want to have eyes on a horizontal level. Sometimes you can see people side bended, but they still keep their eye gaze proper. If somebody naturally have one eye higher, lower, they're going to compensate to have it in a horizontal, because that's how nervous system and brain receives the signal from outside to determine, am I standing, am I lying down, am I horizontal, am I inclined? With the age factors like Walker muscles, changes in visions, condition like arthritis can affect our balance. Something hurts, we don't move as much, we're getting weaker, we're getting avoiding the range of motion, something becomes stiff. And as it happens, we don't really see how it happens until we comes to the realization, hey, I really fell behind. Meaning like, hey, last summer it was okay, why I cannot walk this summer? Because I was sitting through the whole winter, I wasn't moving around, it was rainy, it was cold, it was windy, so I was just sitting and not moving. So nevertheless, what happens with the body at this time? Body decreases your muscle mass. Your muscle mass decreased, you lost your strength. So next summer come in, you're not able to do your stuff. So that's very important to upkeep your mobility, getting to RSS, getting around to library, getting around with your people, and whatever you do in communities and getting around, that will help to maintain your functional level. Besides doing additional exercises, doing your work, that's also, yes, it's heavy, nobody likes it, but we need to do it. And that also still gives us feedback to upkeeping our physical health. So that is very, very important. By the way, muscle mass is one of the biggest indicators for pure longevity. Meaning, if you not stop losing your muscle mass, you can extend your lifespan. You can live longer, simply terms. And basically, you need to understand that after age 30, the sarcopenia starts to eat out our muscle. That's our natural rhythm, how we losing muscle mass after age 30. That's how the mechanism turn on the aging processes. If up to 30, we're building up naturally, if we're active and it's much easier, after 30, if you're not upkeeping it, you're going to be losing and losing and losing. One of the common terms that you already familiar with in conditions such as osteoporosis. Osteoporosis, that's your weakening of the bone. Why it happens? Because we're not putting so much stress on it. And the body is a very efficient tool. You're not losing it, you're losing it. But why would you upkeep something that takes so much of energy from you that if you're not using it? So that's why your body drops. Next thing, tips for staying safe on slippery surfaces. Take small, careful steps. Walk slowly and keep your feet flat on the ground. Meaning, don't tip it toe on an unknown surface. So you're going to tip it toe as an exercise, but you want to make sure the path is clear. You want to make sure if you're unfamiliar or unsure where you're walking, right now especially, on the outside, there's a bunch of leaves. Leaves to leaves, they don't have much of the grip. Therefore, you want to make sure you step carefully in case you're feeling like it's slippery, so you can stop yourself at any given time. So you shorten your step. So in that case, you don't find yourself in a half-split position on the street. Use handrail whenever available for support. Wear shoes with a good grip on slip sock or non-slip socks. So at home, non-slip socks. So in that case, you...
I think we just have to move you. People are saying they can't hear you as well. So I'm just going to try moving this a little closer and see
just
if
put it right here.
I'll face that towards you.
You can put it this closer even.
Okay, perfect.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Not too many.
Good. Yeah. So, we stopped at the wearing proper shoes with a good grip, meaning your shoes is not going to go anywhere if you slip. They will stop by the gripping the surface. If your shoes have a more harder sole, you might try it, like, just if does it grip, does it not. If it's completely like ice skates, that's something you're considering changing. They might also keep in mind different shoes might present with the different conditions. Since the rubber becomes harder when it's cold, you want to make sure you have rubber that actually cold resistant, so it will be grippy when it's cold. Right now, there's a variety of different product on the shoes that you can have with the ice resistant surface that literally they have a sandpaper on the bottom, so you're not going to slip and fall for no reason. Be mindful of wet and icy spots, especially outdoors. So not only outdoors you can expect that, sometimes inside, hallways. The hallways not like here, but like have a little bit more wind and everything, you can find it right before the entrance. So always pay attention. It's very important for you. Keep floor clear of clutter and use non-slip mats in areas and bathrooms. So when you're transitioning from the bathroom out, I already had a couple of patients who unfortunately fell in their bathroom because that transitions put them in a slip, or they slipped inside of the bathroom and hit their head and end up in a hospital. It's not really a good thing to end up in that situation. So make sure you can use the mats for the bathroom specifically that will prevent that slippage inside. Use the rails. Make sure you're asking a super building to make sure that there's a proper rails that you can grip on when you're transferring from one side, from inside of the bathtub or a shower tap outside. The importance of proper footwear. So we touched it on non-slip resistance shoes. So there's a couple of pictures. So some of them Vionic, New Balance, or Proform. Some of them, majority, all three models can be received by the prescriptions, by majority of the suppliers. If your supplier does not have it, ask them specifically. But you want to make sure laced up or Velcro strap. You want to make sure your shoes are sitting tight on your feet. I know it's not super nice. They might, some people might call them ugly, but they're safe. It's much better to be safer than super trendy. It's a breaking point for some of you, I understand, but it is important that your shoes are snug. Those slip-ins, they're comfortable. I know they're much easier, but this is way safer. Safety should be your priority. So that also will make sure that even if the shoe grips, you're not going to left your shoe on the sidewalk and then you're going to fall. Because sometimes with the slip-on shoes, that's what happens. The shoe stays on the sidewalk and you're out of the shoe on the ground. So we want to avoid that. Shoes with adjustable closures, meaning laces or straps. Shoes with wide stable soles. You don't want to get those super specific running shoes with a wide toe, very narrow heel. You want to have a well-rounded surface throughout the whole foot to have a good grip throughout. Also, pay attention. Some shoes have a foamy surface, meaning they might feel comfortable, like a lot of Skechers models. They made out of the foam. They might look that they have a good grip, but unfortunately, they're not as rubber. They're not going to have that grip to hold you on the ground. So, what you need to avoid? You need to avoid heavy shoes. So never put heavy shoes on your legs. If you feel they're too heavy, that's not good because it might prevent you from lifting, especially what I see frequently with aging people, like you're not lifting your feet too much of the ground. That puts you at risk. And then if you have a heavy shoes, big boots, and you trip over, that's not a good day in the office. Check threads and patterns. Here's an example. It still might have a collar and some thread, but it's already eaten out here in the center, and that's already not gripping you, because it's one of the push points that you push through when you're walking. So it is important to upkeep it. And if you see the thread worn out, even at one side, you're already time to replace them, even if they look good outside. Have a good, comfortable insole. Spanko-total support, like they're one of the most easy to fit in, easy to break in, and they will make sure that your shoe, like if it's hugging your sole, and it's going to give you a good response when you're walking. So it's pick a proper sole that's comfortable for you. And it's going to be done during your physical therapy sessions. Our team is knowledgeable about it. If you have questions on the physical therapy examinations, hey, I also have a question about my shoes. We're always going to be able to give you proper recommendations. Okay, so I brought up a couple of the researches that you can, with the abstract, that basically proving the point that balance training is beneficial for people and you're able to change it. So abstract conclusion study highlights the effective balance training in people with multiple sclerosis. The multiple sclerosis, that's a terminal illness. It doesn't go anywhere. So you're constantly going down, down, down. You're losing the functions. But with the proper training, you're able to improve your state. You're able to retain some of the functions for much longer time. So ALS, same thing. ALS, unfortunately, it's much faster progression than MS, but it does able to give you a hold up. Parkinson's disease, same thing with the Parkinson's. When you have a severe effect on your gait, your walking ability and the posture, with the physical therapy, you can upkeep your conditions, you can upkeep your function. So even with that thing, all of them, all three are terminal, but you still can upkeep your consciousness and still can function. So if you can do it with a terminal illness, you can be much more successful if you don't have those diagnoses. And you can upkeep your balance and you can upkeep your functions despite your age.
We had one question online, yes, in the chat. Let me know if you want to keep them till the end or not. But the one question
Let me answer the question.
Tread? What is the best tread to look for?
Best tread, for example, if we're talking for the shoes more for the winter situations and rain, there's a company that's called Vibram, and it has a yellow logo on the bottom. I unfortunately don't have anybody probably wearing it right now. I'm going to pull it up online a little bit later. So Vibram, one of those like golden standards, what you can find to address that anti-slip. Also, in the name or function descriptions, you're going to have that anti-slip function. Skechers, Workman shoes, not every Skechers are good. Very few Skechers, only one Workman series. Those are good because they come with the anti-slip sole, and that's usually going to be that Vibram. So always check the shoes with anti-slip sole. That's basically what you're looking for when you're picking a shoe. Does it answer the question?
Yes, that answered the question.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
All right, let's move on. So, gait adaptation for fall prevention from movable platform to slippery floor. So one of the things that we have in our clinic, not in Hudson, but in Riverdale, it's only 10 minutes away from here, we have a rack for the balance training. So for those who are a little bit more advanced, because even I can't hold their legs and balance, for those who are advanced, we can transfer the practice from the transition from the slippery surfaces into the rigid surface. And here we can practice for somebody who's basic. So we create the atmosphere, because when you're training for balance or any other training, you need to be specific. You need to be specific in a way that I'm reproducing the situation that can put me at risk when I'm walking. I'm reproducing the situation that can put me at risk when I'm transferring from the chair to standing or from the getting out through the curb. So we were producing and making sure you have that drill in, because you need to be specific already. Sitting on the bike or pushing a new step or lifting weights, not going to get you better with the walking. So we building the program that you not only strengthening the muscles, but you also can carry over that skill into the specific walking skill and balance, as a matter of fact, skill. So we're training you to be able to walk on the different types of the surfaces. And there's a research support that it does work. So this was there. No, hold on, I went the wrong way. Okay, understanding training balance, impairment and multiple sclerosis. We have that. Okay, repeated slip training and emerging parenting for preventing of slip.
Can you speak a little bit slower?
Okay, we'll do.
Thank you.
We'll do. So abstract for this research states, focused on repeated slip training, this research showed that preparing older adults for slippery condition improve stability and fall prevention. The study underscore value of sleep stimulation in physical therapy to reduce fall risk in challenging environments. So that what I mentioned before, we selecting the environment for you and trying to prepare you. Same as the specific Navy SEALs will be trained into similar conditions where they're going to be deployed. Same here, we have to create or reproduce the condition. Sometimes we might do a perturbation, meaning to knock you off the balance for you to be able to recover. So we put you through the training to make sure that you facing the similar challenging outside, outdoors, you can have that strategy in place. Basically, when you introduce the movement strategy, movement pattern, such as lifting, stepping to the side, recovering if somebody losing the, stepping back, recovering the balance if somebody knock you off the balance, that what we reproduce. And now if that happens in a, on the street, your brain know, okay, I'm falling backwards, I'm not going to panic and throw my hands out, I'm just going to put my leg back and recover my balance. So it all comes through the pattern introductions in the brain. Exercise to improve balance, and there's the three go-to exercises that usually can be safely performed at home. It's a heel-to-toe walk. Heel-to-toe walk, it's a simple when you're walking, and usually if you do it at home, you would do it cruising against the wall. I always suggest to have one hand on the wall, so you can do it cruising or against the countertop. You just touch it, make sure you can do it, and this is how you practice it.
But not on something that has wheels.
Not to something that has wheels. Unless you're walking with a walker, you have it in front of you, and you can do it like this, but you want to make sure it's tall and properly set up for you. Then single leg stance, that's also done, can be done, but has to be done when you're holding to something. You can hold your hand right here in case you fall, feel that you're falling, you can always recover yourself. You have to stand, give yourself a little bit, 10, 15 seconds to build it up. If you feel like, oh, I can't even do 3-5 seconds, don't practice, get evaluated, and we will build you up. Usually when people come into our clinic and saying, hey, I have a balance issue, my physician wants me to practice balance, we'll do the test, find your baseline, and we'll build you up. Don't expect fast results. Research indicates between 6 to 8 months, sometimes 12 months, for a significant big change in the balance. So it's a constant work, constant long work to recover it, but you can recover it. And you, because you're preventing one of the biggest and one of the widest cause of death right now, accidental traumas due to falls. That's number two in the cause of death, unfortunately, against the, for people 65 plus. And chairs, sit down to stand up. So everybody has a chair at home. You just safely stand up and sit down on your chair. And it means like, even if you're tired, just do another 10. You do your regular chores throughout the day, just do 10 more, and that's already gonna be a change because it's upkeeping your strength. When in doubt, ask for help, meaning, hey, I'm not sure if I can cross it. Hey, I'm not sure if it's slippery. Wait for somebody, ask a fellow next to you, like, hey, give me a hand, please help me cross it. Don't rush. People are kind, so I believe majority, most of the people are kind and they okay to help. Remember that asking for help is a smart and safe choice. Stay mindful of your surrounding and prevent falls. So meaning, be aware of what's happening. I know we frequently rush. Hey, I need to do this. I need to buy that. I didn't call him. Slow down. Hey, you caught yourself. It's okay. Slow down. Stand up. Look around. Find the object around you. Find that you're in place and continue on. If you're going to call somebody later, nothing's going to happen. If you're going to be late for 5 minutes, nothing's going to happen. As long as you can get there safe and sound, that's very important. Additional tips. So what you can do to start feeling better, start working and find out if you even need to do something. It's a regular eye exam to make sure, hey, my vision is good. As we said on the beginning, vision is one of the biggest things that give us proper environmental read and understanding where we at. Good lighting. A lot of people like darker light. My wife especially, she loves it dark. Like in, I can't take it. I need everything to be visible like it's in a surgical room. So that's frequently gets us in the beef. But nevertheless, you need to see where you're going. You need to see where you're standing. You need to see where you're cooking. That's safety. That's one of the biggest points for safety. Turn that light up. Change that light bulb to a stronger one. That help prevent to hitting an obstacle that you haven't seen.
We have one question. What can you do if you start falling forward?
To stop training for falling forward. So basically, that's a step forward pattern. That's basically a person comes in for evaluation and we finding the proper technique to teach you how to build that step forward pattern. Because when you, as soon as you start feeling it, you have to have certain signals and you have to teach your brain to trigger that step forward to stop you falling forward. Plus, we need to understand what condition brings you to that falling forward situation. Because normally you're just going to put your hands up ahead and people end up with a fractured wrist on top of the fractured hip after that fall. So that's just required proper training. But it's possible, but it has to be evaluated because the different people have a different, every single balance case will be different. So that's why I'm not rushing into saying like, hey, start doing this. But you can start with the same tandem walk, like heel to toe walk while you're holding to something basically at home. If you can do it safely, if you feel you're losing balance, don't do it. Come for the evaluation and we can get you what you need. All right, going forward, consistency with the balance exercises. As I said, it takes 6 to 12 months. You have to be consistent, not only in PT, but also at home. So that's constant work that will re-educate your brain, that will introduce you to the movement patterns, that will solidify the skill. Same as any other skill, kneading. And first, it takes your time to learn, and then you can do it with the closed eyes. Same goes with the balance, same skill. Regular physical therapy screening. Don't wait until it hurts. Don't wait until you fall. That's a little bit too late. If you're saying, hey, it's stiff, let me be checked. Right now, even Medicare suggests you to go at least once a year for the physical therapy checkup as you do your annual checkup. It's a little bit different. If your physician didn't tell you, doesn't mean you don't need it. It could be a step forward. Remember, you're taking care of yourself. Nobody will take care of or will be interested to take care of yourself more than you are.
Excuse me.
Yes.
In the physical therapy checkup, is it not only the balance, but they check?
We're checking, like, you come in, like, hey, I want to be checked out all around. Please show me my weaknesses. That's
so
it.
Your upper body strength, like,
we will check everything.
Get up off the floor,
yeah.
You know,
we can do the training getting up off the floor. I already brought that one sample. We had actually this patient started to come back right now, but. She initially took about 3 minutes to get up off the floor. By the time we did a couple of sessions, it took her less than 40 seconds. When you know what to do, it's much faster. Your body already introduced to the movement.
Yeah, this I also have a question, if you don't mind.
Yes,
I have a question. Yeah. So the question is, you mentioned something about closed eyes. Are you
yes.
saying that we are, when we are very comfortable with those what you mentioned, at that point we do all of those things with closed eyes, or I didn't understand
that. That's going to be under supervision, because you're going to do it with somebody who can catch you if you're actually starting to fall. That's more advanced training, and that's done as well. So if you're comfortable standing on one leg with open eyes, there's no point for me to continue doing that. I need to make it more challenging. I'm either going to ask you to close your eyes and see how that happens, or I'm going to put you on an unstable surface, like on a foam or on something like a foam-like surface.
And where are you coming from? What's your therapy place?
Hudson Physical Therapy or Riverdale Physical Therapy. One is located in 2600 building, Netherlands Avenue, and another one, 2735 Henry Hudson.
Thank you.
Suite 103. So that basically, based on your needs, we selecting your therapy and skill and level of the therapy that you need. And as I said, when you do your annual checkup, you just show up, hey, I want to do my checkup, I want to see my weaknesses, I want to see my strength. We will sit down, we'll show you, hey, you're weak here, you're strong here, we need what's important for you and what you need to do it. Because sometimes we might think, oh, like you mentioned, I need to be able to get up from the floor. But then your core is super weak, and having super weak core will improve everything on top of it. So we can have that discussion and identify what is more important and what is needed for you, and how to build up your goals and get you in. So with that, that's going to be the end of the presentation. I'm open for the questions right now. So
I like also to know like a few exercises for the core. Okay. You know, maybe one or two. I'm not saying 10, but one or two exercises for the core.
Core exercises, like what you can improve with the core with the simple sit to stand from the chair. That's one. Another one is like, let me see so you can see me here. For example, I'm standing right now, and I'm like, while I'm standing, I'm just pushing into the table, not with my hands, but with my core, like this. I'm pushing in the table, so I feel my stomach tighten up. That's one of the basic exercises to strengthen your core that you can start. As I'm pushing for a couple of seconds into the tribune or sitting on in the front of the table, and I can push my hands into the table, that will activate my stomach. You have to feel the stomach tightness, and that will train already the muscles. You do it 3 times with a push for 10 seconds, and you repeat it 3 times 8, meaning 8 repetitions of 3 sets. That will help you to tighten up the muscles. But as I said, I don't know your level, I don't know your skill, it's very hard to give you appropriate exercise, because this is could be too basic or not enough for you simply to give the enough strength. For muscles to be strong, it's not just good to do same exercise over and over. You need to surprise your exercises. You need to move them hard. A lot of people who has a good physical background, meaning they're athletes, professionals, or players, or they go to yoga and Pilates for the past 25 years, they do usually fall into routine of doing same exercise over and over. As we mentioned in the beginning, your body is a very efficient machine that will make it easy to do something that you do frequently. So your muscles not going to work hard, even if you do hard exercises, because they are accustomed for it for the past 1 year. So you need to switch and pick exercise every time when you're selecting a program and change them every so often.
I have another question here online. What is a physical therapy screening, and will it be covered by insurance, basically Medicare, and do you need a prescription?
So for the first visit on the Medicare, you can come in without the prescription, but you should get the prescription within 10 visits or so. So you coming for the screening, it's same as annual. We can check your strength. You're coming in, hey, I want to be checked out all around. I need to check my strength in the shoulders, legs, balance, because I feel this is could be a problem, or I just want to know where my baseline. So same as you coming to your physician, you're not always coming like with a tremendous pain or anything. So you come in, we determine where you at, what you have weakness, what you have strong, where's your strong side, where we can improve, what you need to take care of it. You might be like, hey, every winter my knees bothering me, but they do not bother me now, so I want to start building them and strong, make them strong before they actually start bothering me. So that's the purpose of the screening, same as to make sure that you don't develop anything and catch it if it's starting to develop before it actually becomes a problem. And yes, we do accept all the major med. Usually if you call one of our office, you give us the information and we able to determine and tell you beforehand, hey, this is a copay, this is a deductible, do you have any or you don't have any? And there's no surprises, so we let you know ahead of time. And if we didn't let you know that you need to pay something, that means you don't pay.
Just one question. The Hiltel, not the Hiltel that you mentioned for the exercise, but like race walkers go heel toe,
yeah,
when they walk, is that advisable for a slippery?
With a slipper, you have to show, if you know, like, hey, that's a pothole in front of me or something like that could be slippery, you want to have the full contact with the floor. So meaning your heel and toe, like, on 1 foot, full contact.
Yeah, that's...
And before you just starting the heel.
So that's
and
good,
you switch,
yeah.
You're not going to be, like, because normally you're going to be on the heel and toe when you're walking like this at any given time, when you're walking fast. But when you cautiously, you first heel, then full foot, then I'm switching the leg, heel, full foot. So like that's more about the strategy, about how to walk on the ice surface. So you don't just want to do this way. You just heel, toe, I'm feeling secure, I'm pushing off. So that's a strategy.
And what about going backwards the same way?
Backwards, you need to practice it. I'm not going to advise anybody practice without supervision going backwards. So you need to practice it. Like, if you, why would you walk backwards?
Well, I guess to challenge yourself.
Please do it super, with the supervision. It's a great exercise, but you need to do it with the supervision.
Yeah, thank you.
So you can come, you can check out, you can show what you do. We can even, for example, who's more active and more independent, they come in for the screen, we can develop the program, and then off you go with your gym exercises if you're a gym member or anything like that. I have people who's coming for physical therapy for strengthening, yet they still join the Pilates group and anything, and that works great for the conjunction. For some people who's more advanced, they continue their gym exercises and gym sections and running, but we do more working on to make sure that their problem not coming back. Have one of the advanced certified runner who's just come for the fine tuning once every other week, but he runs 25 miles like nothing. Like, but he's still making sure that he's upkeeping his form and he doesn't have his back problem.
We have a question, Beverly. I think you have a question, and then somebody else had a comment in the chat about exercise to do to strengthen your knee.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I do all my exercises in the therapy pool, which is warm water, or I'll do it in the hot tub if I can tolerate it because it's more soothing. And it's also narrower, and I have a seat to fall back onto, and usually with people around. But
so,
the crystals in the ear were what was the cause of me going backwards, raking leaves, and all of a sudden, there was the curb. I could always sense it before. Don't ask me why I didn't that day. But of three ear canals, there are three appointments. And on the first one, they bent my head. I went down onto the gurney and voila, I was fine. So when I had problems with balance, I said, maybe I need to have my eyes and cataracts fixed. Once they were fixed, my husband noticed I had confidence. I could see. And you're right about the eye exam, but don't forget about the crystals in the ear.
Yeah, that's basically done. That's with the vertigo. We're very successful with working with that. I actually, for the past 3-4 months, I had more vertigo cases than for the past 9 years. So the problem with the vertigo, it's very, very common and very, very acute right now, I would say. And a lot of people having it from nowhere, like, hey, I never had it, and all of a sudden my whole room's spinning.
And I was cautioned it could come back in 3 years, and it's been 3 or 4 years. But again, you have to look at everything, and the cataract helped. I don't have to wear glasses anymore except little readers. And then I also gave up risky sports. I no longer do cross-country skiing in the front yard because that was my humerus I broke. And my elbow was going down the stairs and was always the left side. So I said, well, the shoulder's next. I think I better put away the ski patrol jacket. And I gave my skis and skates away 2 years ago when I moved to New Hampshire, which is skiing country, although global warming is challenged. And I have to admit that adapting and being modifying in my older age, because I have osteopenia and I'm 77, so I have to be smart. So it's working smarter, not harder.
But also keep in mind that exercising in the water does not reproduce your exercises on the gravity condition and standing. So that's a good on the beginning, but you have to try to progress whenever it's possible. Also, I'm not aware of your level, but you have to work with a PT who's close to you if you're in New Hampshire. So
I did. And that's why she showed me all of everything in the water on land. But when I have to go back to zero, because like I had acute bronchitis, that's going to affect the ears and the balance. So I had to start from scratch. So I know how to start slow and sure and then end up on land again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so just make sure you have a proper consulting, like right at the place where you're at, because I'm trying to transition to a normal functional exercises as soon as possible. Vertigo,
correct.
Also, you can do ask your PT prophylactically perform the vestibular maneuvers. That will reassure, even if it's going to trigger for a short time period of time, it's still going to be good to check on it. And basically perform it from time to time to make sure it doesn't catch you not prepared.
Thank you for the reminder. Thank you.
Okay, there was a comment about...
There was a something, the question is there something we can do at home to strengthen the knee for prevention? Not a problem yet. And then we'll let you...
Course.
And then we'll hold off more questions until the end.
Yeah, like that's actually already the end. I'm just answering the questions. So I already said everything what's in the presentation. So nevertheless, so what's for at home? LAQ is basically, I'm going to put my video here. Let me see so I can see myself. Give me 1 second. Give me 1 second. I just want to show a couple of exercises what can be done. Cheryl, can you hold it for me?
Sure.
Okay. Oh. Here, I'm gonna spotlight you so people can see you. I think you have to stop the share maybe so people can see you better.
Okay, stop share. No, okay. Can you guys see me?
Yeah, we can.
Okay. So what you can do, okay.
Closer to the end is one.
Safety first. Okay, so sit to stand. This is make sure that you're feeling it here, and you're also standing up from the edge. Make sure that your ankles behind your knees, hands in front. If you're unstable, you can always have a chair in front of you here. So when you do this way, when you're holding it, you want to make sure you squeeze your cheeks to make sure it's tight. You're standing and down. So you can do 3 sets of 6, 3 sets of 8. Make sure your knees don't hurt. Make sure you're stable. Another exercise which is commonly used is LAQ, lumbar quad. Up, straight, back, down. Up, straight, back, down. Another thing is simply can be sitting marches. Keep in mind, knee, just strengthening the knee, it doesn't come simple just with the knee. It's also your hip. Your hip is weak, your knee will be weak. So you need to do this. Stand up, hold to something. Kick to the side. Not like this. To the side. And a little bit to the back. This is strengthening this muscle that upkeep your hips when you're walking and switching them. This 3 exercises is very basic. Do them every day, 3 sets of 8, twice, 3 times a day. That will help you and support you a little bit. Other questions? Yes.
Yeah, my left knee just buckles every once in a while. I'm walking and then it decides it's not going to hold me.
So
but I have the walker.
So patient is asking about the buckling of the knee. So that happens frequently because of the weakness. You're not walking enough. You transitioned a lot of time since you're walking with a walker. You transition a lot of the weight on the walker, and the rest is becoming just weaker. So you need to specifically target. Come for PT. We'll do evaluation. We'll tell you what to do specifically. specialists in this building. Some of them you might be applicable for you, some of them not. There could be the case that you're simply not able to do them. So we need to pick something that you're able to do, plus in addition to train the rest. Because the problem is...
It might only buckle once a day. You know?
Today it's once a day. Give it a couple of months, it's going to be twice a day. And like, what are you waiting for? I'm saying like, today it's once a day. In a couple of months, it's going to become twice a day. And what are you waiting for? So once a day, it's more than enough. Like, because one buckle can knock you out of the balance. Because if that happens with the transition, that's where it's dangerous. If there's nobody to catch you, that's a significant threat. Good. But don't let it get weaker. The more weaker you get, the more behind you fall. So the sooner you start, the better it is. And know it's annoying. And know it's a lot. We have a lot of things. But don't fall in that prison that you're waiting until that something horrible has to happen and then you have no choice just to go to PT. You have a luxury right now to do that conscious choice. Other questions? Anybody? Online?
I have a question. I have a couple of questions. The strengthening of the core in the standing, what I do is I put my arms across this way, if you could see me. Yes. And I stand and I sit and stand and sit. And I could do that continually for 30 seconds without a problem. But every time I stand up, my knee, which has arthritis, is saying, ouch. Should I continue doing it or should I?
Place yourself on the pillow. Like basically you have your chair, put the pillow or some dense foam. So to build yourself higher.
I'm a very short person. I won't be able to.
So like prep yourself up. So you're going to shorten the range for the knee and you're still going to exercise a little bit of your legs.
I see.
But you're not going to trigger because the idea is sometimes the patient depends on the level of arthritis. It could be the case it's unavoidable, but it could be a case that avoidable. So I don't know exact situation with the knee. So sometimes the pain is different. There's good pain, there's bad pain. If you keep going, the pain increasing, that means stop and put the ice on it. If you do it and the ouch is still the same and does not increase and does not affect your ability, I would actually switch it from 30 seconds to just 3-4 sets of 8, 4 sets of 10 if you can handle it comfortably, and then just see, hey, my knee is feeling better at the end or worse. Or actually when I'm done with my exercises and my knee hurts for 2 hours, I would ice it after exercises regardless and just get evaluated.
Yeah, another question, I thank you for that. Another question is, if one of us were to come to your facility, would there be an actual physician there who could give the prescription and not have to go to a second doctor?
So Medicare, you can start without the, for example, how Medicare works. If you have your physician, let's say Dr. Joe, and you coming to us first before going to Dr. Joe, who's your physician, you coming to us, we create the initial eval, we send the progress note to Dr. Joe. If he signs it off, we're good. That becomes our prescription. If Dr. Joe says, hey, I need to see you, you will have to see the Dr. Joe and get the prescription. But meanwhile, you already started your PT. You're not waiting to see Dr. Joe first. You can start your PT and you have a 30 days or 10 visits, whatever comes first, to get that prescription. You don't have to do like, let me see Dr. Joe first, and then I'm going to see to go to the PT.
And another question, how long is a session, a single session? And are you, and during that session, are you with a single person the entire time?
No, it's a mix and match. So first, it's evaluation takes about hour 10, hour 20, so in general for the whole sessions, because it's an easier session in a way that we need to determine what's the problem. We need to do evaluation. That has to be done by PT at all times. And as we're building up the plan, as we're doing our assessment, there's exercises. If I set you up on a bike, I'm leaving you on the bike. I have assistants who's overseeing you on the bike. I don't need to hold your hand. If I give you exercises, I am overseeing you. How you doing it? I don't need to hold your hand every second. So in general, you having your program built up, and whenever I need it, I'm there to make sure I'm doing the proper corrections and make sure you're doing it correct. So that's usually what it happens.
And is a single session 45 minutes, a half hour?
45 to an hour. It depends on your level. Some people cannot tolerate the 45 minutes. Some people can tolerate up to 2 hours. We usually like run about hour 10, but like follow-up visits. It also depends on your level. So how much you can tolerate? You can tolerate an hour. Usually people like on average hour 10.
Okay, thank you. You're very thorough.
You're welcome. Other questions, please. Yes,
please. Do you do physical therapy?
Yes. Question was if we do physical therapy for sciatica. Answer is yes. Anything else? Guys, remember.
I have a question too over here.
Yes, please.
If you can hear me.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, great. Thank you. These are wonderful questions and wonderful answers. I think with my slip and fall weakness, it's not any diagnosed injury, but it would be my ankle, my left ankle. It seems that I have a tendency to go out with it. It's, in other words, it might bend outwardly to the outside of my foot. Do you have any exercise to strengthen that?
Yes. I'm not going to jump in to give you exercise necessarily right now, and I'm sorry for that because it's a little bit more specific thing. It sounds like you have a chronic strain in the ankle and chronic like subluxation, either so. If it bends out, could be combined with the overpronation when your arch is dropping. So when that happens, I need to see exactly what's needed to be strengthened. And also, it's usually more complex than just the ankle. The ankle problem tend to affect all the chain up, meaning knee and hip. Research also indicates a lot of hip weaknesses on the similar side that the ankle that suffers the problem. So that has to be treated as a whole chain. So you cannot just saying like, oh, I'm going to put the orthotic or I'm going to do this exercise for the ankle. It's going to cure the problem. It's usually a chain problem.
So like, well, I'm... I think someone else was maybe.
Oh, you know what else? Because I remember.
Helen, you're on. We can hear you.
Okay.
Thank you. So I had this feeling, like for example, I'm standing while we're talking here, and I just try to keep my mind on my foot, and that I'm more feeling the inside of the foot as I'm standing on the ground. Is that?
So it
not helpful, or is it
overpronation? So it might require additional correctional orthotics.
Okay.
The orthotics will not be the only one solution for that. So because there's a, from what you say,
thank you. Thank you for addressing.
Injury there. So that might require a little more specific plan to be treated. So get evaluated.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions? Anybody?
Okay, you were talking about, you know, heavy shoes. I have heavy boots from L.L. Bean that are supposedly a good grip. And whenever I change, you know, for the season, if it's bad outside, I really have to, like, get adjusted to walking with them. So is it not the right thing to be wearing?
So, first of all, your winter boots will be heavier than your regular summer
shoes,
boots.
Yeah.
So, or sandals. So that's also a give a trade. So it's also start wearing them when it's drier, so you get accustomed. Don't take them for the long walk, so you get getting more comfortable with them. Because as I said, you want to make sure that you're clearing the ground as you're making the step.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, guys.
I'm coming back. Boys, this was inspirational.
Ladies,
please
be safe. Make sure to be aware of your surroundings. Don't step in the things that look shady. Like, make sure you always know where you're going and look around. Okay, stay safe.
Thank you
very, very much. Okay, thank you so much for coming. It's really very informative.
Wonderful topic. Thank you.